Penguin Random House Audio presents Only in Naples, Lessons in Food and Famiglia from My Italian Mother-in-Law. This is the author, Katherine Wilson. For my parents, Edward and Bonnie Wilson, and for my sister Anna. Introduction. In Greek mythology, sirens hang out on the rocky cliffs near Naples with their gorgeous curly hair, singing songs that entice sailors to the coast. They draw ships in with their voices, luring them to danger, to shipwreck, to death. No one hears their song and comes out alive. Odysseus was desperate to hear it. The song was meant to be sweeter than anything in the world, and he wanted to be the only human being to experience it and live to tell the tale. So, with a mix of pride, curiosity, and smarts, he made a plan. He got earplugs for his crew and had them tie him to the mast. When his ship passed the sirens, he screamed to his men to untie him, to change course and head toward land. They didn't, and he survived. Afterward, I'm sure Odysseus was glad that his crew didn't listen, that his earplugged employees kept him safe. But I'm also sure that he wanted to go back. Not just to see and hear the sirens, but to set foot on the magical land under the volcano that was called Neapolis, the new city. And this was before pizza was even invented. I didn't arrive in Naples tied to a mast. I arrived on a packed Delta flight from Washington, D.C. in the fall of 1996. There were no sirens, but I was sucked in and transformed all the same. My head was full of collegiate curiosity. My body was full of appetites that I didn't quite know what to do with. Goethe said, "See Naples and die." I saw Naples and started to live. A pizza. When Salvatore sputtered up in his tiny red Fiat for our first meeting, he was over 20 minutes late. The car looked like a tin can and sounded like it was on its last legs. It spat a steady stream of exhaust, and I started to cough. Salvatore responded with two short honks of his horn and a big smile. It was the first time I was meeting this guy, and he was 20 minutes late. What was that? I was fresh out of college and had arrived in Naples a few days earlier to start a three-month internship at the U.S. consulate there. I was standing outside the entrance of the boarding school where I rented a room, wearing a boxy blue jacket with black trousers. My internship wasn't as much a career move as it was a rite of passage. Members of my family did an experience abroad during or after college. Big leather photo albums in my parents' attic in Washington show my father waspy and smiling in Bordeaux in 1961, my mother all suaded out in Bologna in 1966. They'd learned foreign languages and they'd had the time of their lives. Now that it was my turn, where was I going to go? Naples was not a logical destination. When I'd visited Italy on vacations as a kid, we avoided the city or passed through it as quickly as we could to get to Pompeii or Vesuvius. Naples was dirty and dangerous, we heard. My grandfather, whose parents were from Calabria, said that Neapolitans could steal your socks without taking your shoes off. "You really should go to Tuscany," family friends had told me. "Have you seen Siena, Florence?" The serene splendor of Tuscany would have been appropriate for an upper-class girl like me. It felt like what I was supposed to do, and I'd always been very good at doing what I was supposed to do. I spent my childhood overachieving at private schools, and in college, I could have majored in surpassing expectations or making mommy and daddy proud. It was time for a change. The American consul of Naples was a fellow alum of my parents' graduate school of international relations. I'd been seated next to him the previous spring at a fundraising dinner in Washington, and he asked me if I'd considered Naples for my experience abroad. He could arrange an unpaid internship in the political office of the consulate if I was interested. Naples? I thought, stolen socks and wallets, the mafia, corruption. I also thought, pizza. I was intrigued. I bounced the idea off people who asked what I was going to do after graduation. I was thinking of going to Naples, I told them. That was when I got the look. The look was a wide-eyed, beware facial expression, accompanied by warnings of, it's filthy, it's dangerous, and even the good guys and the bad guys all look alike. There's no way to tell the difference. Aha, I thought. Sounds fascinating. I now know that Naples is like New York City. You either love it or you hate it. And if you love it, there's no use proselytizing. Those who hate it will not be converted. There's a chaotic, vibrant energy about Naples that forces you to let go and give in. If you fight it, judge it, or even hide from it, you might as well get out before you get your wallet snatched. Lucky I hadn't gotten my wallet snatched waiting for this Salvatore guy, I thought, as he opened the creaking door of his car and got out to introduce himself. 20 minutes? It had been Salvatore's mother, Raffaella Valone, who had found me the room at the boarding school where I was staying. After working out the details of the internship, I had asked the consul's help with housing. He immediately passed the issue on to his wife, an Italian signora who hung out not only with diplomats, but also Neapolitan society. She knew that the lady who got things done at benefit lunches, charity galas, and bridge tournaments was Raffaella Valone. Plus, Raffaella had two kids this girl's age. And so Raffaella learned that there was a young woman in need of a sistemazione, a setup. Mi sono mossa subito, is the expression she would use. I got myself moving. She found me a place to stay and told her son, Salvatore, that there was an American girl whom he was to call and meet up with. Salva, she said, take her out. The poor girl knows no one here, and please, don't be late. The next day, I got a call from Salvatore. The telephone was a challenge, as my Italian was very basic and I could only communicate concepts like, I am hungry and I am American. Although I didn't understand most of what Salvatore said, I thought his laugh was adorable. Plus, I didn't know a soul in Naples. The night before, I'd gone out for dinner with two 17-year-old boys I'd met on a bus. I wanted to be in compagnia. So I was glad that, if I'd understood correctly, this Salvatore was going to pick me up the next evening. Worst case scenario, I figured I could practice my Italian. You don't look American, I thought I understood him to say after he introduced himself. Well, he didn't look typically Neapolitan either. He was tall, not muscular, but long and narrow, with a thin torso that emptied into a little pool of tummy that hung over the button of his jeans. His skin was tanned, his lips full, his nose big and Roman. He was wearing a t-shirt that said Miami in bubble letters. I was expecting, nice to meet you, sorry I'm late. But there was no apology, no niceties, no, what do you want to do? There was, however, that adorable laugh again. It was a laugh on an inhale, which started at a high pitch and came down the scale to end at the note of his speaking voice. It was accompanied by a smile that showed lots of perfect white teeth. He opened the passenger door, and the seat squeaked as I sat down. Salvatore seemed too big for this tiny car. His black hair stuck with static to the top. I noticed that his fingernails on the steering wheel were such perfect ovals that they could only have been shaped by a manicurist. He was a boy, not yet a man, who ate and lived well. Salvatore's style of driving did not necessitate keeping his eyes on the road. He looked me in the eyes and tried out his horrific English, with no apologies for messing up his verb forms. How could a boy of 23 be so confident? I felt infantile, passive, silent. Try to say something in Italian, I told myself. Like, for example, where are we going? You can't have zero control over the situation. Dove andiamo? To my apartment. America, America, petrol dollari. American oil dollars? Did he have some idea that I was super rich from oil? I now know that thanks to the TV show Dallas, lots of Italians believe that if Americans have money, it's thanks to Texas oil. But in the car that first evening, I didn't know where this expression came from, only that Salvatore greatly enjoyed saying it, over and over. And then there was that laugh again. My apartment for a 23-year-old Neapolitan didn't mean a dorm room or a flat with a roommate. It meant his parents' apartment.
I'd assume that. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.